So we are exchanging information, you and I, right now, about what we're feeling emotionally through these electromagnetic fields produced by the heart. The heart is actually sending a lot more information to the brain than it ever gets from the brain. Lots of research now showing that it's healthy, it's beneficial for us to feel positive emotional states.
Hello everybody, a warm welcome to Wisdom from North. My name is Janneke and I'm now in sunny California on my Wisdom from North tour around the US. And I'm currently in Boulder Creek at the Institute of HeartMath. Now, this institute was founded in 1991. It is a non-profit research and educational organization with a mission to establish heart-based living and global coherence by inspiring people to connect with their heart's intelligence and guidance. And next to me, I have Howard Martin. He is the executive vice president and spokesperson for HeartMath and has written the HeartMath solution. Now, Howard, much welcome to Wisdom from North, and thank you so much for letting me come here and talk to you about this amazing research that you're doing.
Thank you very much, Janneke, and first of all, welcome to California, to Boulder Creek, California, in the north of California, here at my home. I've been spending some nice time here this summer working on our businesses and on myself and, you know, getting ready to go back out and start my speaking this fall. But I'd like to say hello to everyone who's viewing this video and wish you all the very best. We're just going to have a nice conversation, and hopefully I can share some things that will be meaningful to you and will touch your heart.
Yeah, and let's go back to the beginning when this was founded. It was Doc Childre or Childre?
It's pronounced Childre.
Childre, who founded this. Now, what was his vision? Why did he start with this?
Well, Doc, you know, and I go back over 40 years now. And we've been friends long before HeartMath. And Doc was a man who always felt that, you know, there was change coming in the world. He could see it way in advance. He understood it. It was a change in consciousness, a change that was going to be creating a new world. But that it was going to be very hard. You know, it would be a time of great transition and change, and it was going to be hard on people. And so out of his care, just a caring man, wise and intelligent and caring person, he wanted to develop a system that could be shared with everyone, all walks of life, all places around the world, that could help empower people through these changing times, to give them the ability to find something within themselves that they could use to make this transition that we're all going to go through and are going through as kind and gentle a process as it could be. The approach that he took, and the approach that we took now over 40 years ago, was a heart-centric approach, meaning we found within ourselves an intelligence that was worked in consort with the brain and the mind and all of that, but it was an intelligence that was high speed. It was intuitive. It was that place inside that we often go to when we look for self-security, when we're looking for something, you know, larger than ourselves in a way that moves us beyond our mediocrity into being able to do the things that we usually can't, that very empowered part of ourself, the core authentic self. We found that in the heart, and it was Doc and his guidance with me and others that began to unfold all of that. We didn't have an ambition to be an organization. We were people who were just intent upon changing ourselves, changing our own consciousness, and we went through a step-by-step process to do that. We never thought about having something like HeartMath today or about being authors or speakers or any of that. It just wasn't in our thoughts. But over time, I think just the purity of that work, just the sincerity in which we did it, began to magnetize and draw things to us. And eventually, we, through meeting other people here in California and other places, decided that, and Doc decided that we would put something together that we could then share with the world. We didn't have a business plan. We didn't have some master plan all figured out in the beginning. We just had commitment, and we had, you know, a desire from our own care to begin to share some of the things that we'd experienced in ourselves. So back in 1991 now, a long time ago, we established Institute of HeartMath. Today we have the nonprofit, which you mentioned in the introduction. We have for-profit companies. We have a lot of things. We employ a lot of people. We operate all around the world. It's become, you know, quite large in many ways. And we've established ourselves as a major brand in the new thought and change movement in the world. And it's been an amazing journey. starting with literally nothing except our belief and then seeing it grow us to what we have today. So today we do a lot of things. And I think one of the things we've been most famous for, and it's not certainly limited to this, but it's our scientific research. Because when we started HeartMath, Yannicka, we said, look, if we're going to put out a heart-based system that is designed to have, you know, mainstream impact, we have to do it differently. Mm-hmm. That heart's been talked about thousands of years, and it's revered. It's understood in many ways, and it's accepted in many ways, but it's often just sort of confined to spirituality and philosophy. And we didn't want it to stay there. We can respect those things, but we felt that heart needed to be applied in daily living, where it's really needed the most, the qualities associated with heart. So we chose science to build our bridge, and we recognize that science in today's world carries a lot of weight. And when science says something and shows something empirically, then belief increases and acceptance increases. So we decided that science should be the bridge. And so early on, we began to try to look at heart, and physical heart particularly, and see what was going on there that we didn't know. We believed that there was an intelligence there, but we needed to unfold a scientific understanding of it. So today, our scientific research, which has been published in mainstream medical journals and scientific journals and all kinds of places, has become sort of the bridge that it worked. In other words, it's given us the credibility. So as a result of that, we've been able to provide HeartMath tools and techniques, technology, these things that we have that we developed in such a variety of settings, everything from people involved in very, very serious deep spiritual work right on down to mainstream Fortune 100 companies, school systems, the military. Wow. All kinds of mainstream organizations have adopted HeartMath in some form. And so it's been working in terms of building that bridge and bringing heart into a modern context, to allow us to experience something that we have inside that can and does help us and lift us beyond the chaos and confusion that we often experience today. And that's a, you know, sort of a summary of, you know, what's happened here.
So tell me about this research on the heart, because apparently the heart is not just a pump. It's much, much more.
It's true. Well, we began to look at the physical heart as our starting point in unfolding something that we felt was important in terms of an intelligence we had. So when we looked at the physical heart, we found that there was a lot of research that had been scattered around through the research literature, but nobody knew it. It was like a secret because there was so much research and there's so many little pieces. And so what that research was showing is that the heart was doing more than pumping blood, and that it was appearing to be intelligent, even at a physical organ, as a physical organ, and that it was sending information to the brain and the rest of the body that was essential. And so our researchers, Dr. Roland McCready and his team and associations with other researchers, began to put this picture together and to tell this story. And it's a story that now someone like me, who's not a trained scientist, can understand and then, you know, impart to others. And what we found was is the heart was, in fact, an information processing center in the body, and that it was sending commands to the brain and throughout the entire system that was, in fact, critical information. We found that it did it in four ways. The first way was neurologically, and this is one of those things where it was in the literature, but who knew, right? The heart has a nervous system. It's a very complex nervous system. Next to the brain, it's the most complex part of the nervous system that we have. It's actually studied through a medical field called neurocardiology. And that nervous system communicates with the brain up here in the head, and it does it through a nerve pathway that starts in our heart, but then goes up and goes in through the lower brain centers and then ultimately ends up stopping up in the higher perceptual centers of our brain. And when researchers map out the neurological traffic in our bodies, they can see that the heart is actually sending a lot more information to the brain than it ever gets from the brain. And that brain function is critically dependent upon these signals from the brain, from the heart. So we have this conversation happening neurologically between heart and brain, and we have this very complex nervous system that the researchers actually call the brain and the heart. That's the first way. The second way we found was through what's called a blood pressure wave. If we all now put our finger on our wrist, we feel our pulse. The pulse is actually a wave of energy that's pushing the blood through the veins and the arteries, and it's called the blood pressure wave. The blood pressure wave obviously travels through the entire body because that's how blood gets there. And it changes things in our body as it changes. One of the things that it influences is the brain. The electrical activity in our brains synchronize to changes occurring in the blood pressure wave. And so researchers call that a biophysical communication. The third way is another one of these things that nobody knew. But in 1983, the heart was actually reclassified as part of our hormonal system because they found it produced a number of hormones. Mm-hmm. For example, one of those is called atrial peptide. Mm-hmm. It's a hormone that has one of its jobs is that it reduces the release of cortisol, which is a stress hormone. So I found that interesting. We have a hormone produced by our heart that's slowing down the production of a stress hormone. It also produces a hormone called oxytocin, which many of your viewers may know. It's been generically called a love hormone. Yeah. It's produced in greater amounts when we're in loving states. And these are biochemicals produced by the heart.
I thought it was produced in the brain. Well, that's
also
what
in
we...
the heart. Yeah. And I've been told by scientists that they're seeing now that it could be that the largest producer of oxytocin in our body is actually the heart, not the brain. So that's called a biochemical communication. And it was like, well, who knew in 1984 the heart was reclassified as part of our hormonal system? So that's your third way. These first three ways are interesting, and they're well documented now, well understood, well, you know, well known in the research literature. And they're called what I would call hardwired biological communication pathways. The fourth way is where it transitions and gets very, very interesting. Our heart is an electrical organ. It produces bioelectricity. We go to the doctor. Doctor takes our EKG. They put these electrodes around here. They get this signal, you know, and they look at it to see what the health of the heart is. That's electricity that they're measuring being produced by the heart. The heart is the strongest source of bioelectricity we have, up to 40 to 60 times more powerful than the second most powerful source, which is our brain. So we're producing a lot of bioelectricity from the heart. And that goes to every single cell in our body. Now, the signal is strong enough that it creates an electromagnetic field. It surrounds us 360 degrees and extends beyond our skin out into space about 3 to 4 feet. In the book that I co-authored with Doc Childre, The HeartMath Solution, we reported on another clinic's findings that said they had detected it 8 to 10 feet. Our researchers, using what's called magnetometers, which they felt were a more reliable measurement device, say 3 to 4 feet. But nonetheless, it's a field beyond the skin into space. So right now, you and I are actually interfacing electromagnetically.
And what does that mean or imply?
Well, it implies a lot. For starters, the frequencies in that field change depending upon what we are experiencing emotionally. If I feel upset, angry, irritated, all that, it produces a very incoherent field. Frequencies in the field are like fighting with each other, like it feels inside, right? If I'm feeling emotions that have long been associated with heart, like compassion, care, appreciation, love, patience, respect, dignity, nobility, those kind of feelings, it can produce a very different field. So we are exchanging information, you and I, right now, by what we're feeling emotionally through these electromagnetic fields produced by the heart. The question now goes into other things because it moves beyond biology into physics. How does my field relate to your field? How does my field from the heart relate to the little field of the brain? How do the fields of a group of people relate to one another? And then some of the research we're doing today would be around how does the collective energy produced by the 7 billion people on this planet relate to the energetic fields produced by the earth itself. So now we're looking at information being exchanged through energetic fields, not just through hardwired biology. So when you put all these four things together, it's an interesting story. And it shows that heart, in fact, is a lot more than we have made it to be in modern society. Thousands of years ago, they saw it as a source of intelligence. The writings go back, you know, I've seen writings as early as 4,500 years ago, talking about the heart being a center of intelligence. As modern science came along and the brain began to be understood better, all intelligence began to be assigned to the brain. But what we're finding in today's world as new science emerges is that intelligence is distributed through the entire system and that heart has an intelligence. And that intelligence is essential for us to be happy, balanced, fulfilled people. and to manage the speed of change that we're going through right now as we go through this era that's been generically called the shift. So there's a lot of implications to that. The science is important. It makes heart more believable. It makes my job more believable. What's more important than that, though, is manifesting the qualities of heart in our lives. And seeing those is not as something that's just soft, but seeing it as a dynamic intelligence that can make a difference, that has everything to do with how we perform, how we communicate, how we relate, how we do our jobs, how we raise our families. All those things can be infused with this intelligence of the heart, and there's an increase in the quality of all of that when we do.
So we actually affect each other all the time, just and especially if we are closer to each other, we affect each other even more because our fields are connecting.
Yeah, and science is showing today that we are all, everything is connected energetically. Everything's producing energetic fields, and we're relating energetically all the time. We are relating to this bush right now. It's producing its own form of energetic field. So is the environment that we're in right now. So is the town near us. All these things are energetic fields, and that all living systems are integrated at an energetic level. And the core of our being, the most energetic thing we have is heart. So the connection to so many of those fields and so much of this that's going on has a lot to do with heart.
So in a way, we should make decisions through our heart.
Yeah, I think, you know, heart plays a role in decision making. Obviously, you know, we need the logical linear intelligence of our brain. And it's important in making decisions and navigating life. There's nothing wrong with that. But when we add heart to that, the brain is actually the big winner. It's not a competition here. It's like the brain comes out as a big winner. But when we add heart to things, then we come up with another type of discrimination. It is the type of discrimination that begins to consider things from a more wholeness perspective. It is more intuitive. It bypasses some of the logical step-by-step processes we often go through to reach understanding. It has a lot to do with what we really feel as understanding. And it's an intelligence that does work very, very quickly when we learn how to access it and tune into it. And that's what we teach in our training programs, is how do we explore this within ourselves, and then how do we apply it in very pragmatic ways. Okay. You know, four things, like you mentioned, like decision-making. Mm-hmm. We have a decision-making tool in our training programs, for example. We have a project planning tool in our training programs. We have communication tools based upon heart intelligence in our training programs. We have lots of different tools that are involved in what's called the HeartMath system. So we take this understanding, but we also ground it out so that it makes sense. So, I mean, it's not just, hey, this is great information. We relate to each other through these fields. Isn't that magnificent, you know, and wow and all that? That's fun. But then what do you do with that?
Yeah.
You know, does that make life any better? You know? And that's where we try to take it down into that type of application, so that we use this to make our lives better, not just to be stimulated by interesting information.
Yeah, can you give a little or some examples of the tools that you have? I know you have something that was called freeze frame, which I thought was very interesting. When you're in like this emotional rut, you're like depressed or in a bad mood, and then you do a shift in a way.
Mm-hmm. Let me share one with you that's related. It's actually, and many of the HeartMath techniques are simple. We actually went through a lot of work to get them simple, because we also recognize in today's world, we have the little butterfly relating energetically here. We also recognize that, you know, people don't have a lot of time right now. You know, it's like time is we're already in overload. Most people are. They have too much to do and not enough time. And so things today have to be simplified and get down to the essence of things for them to have the real utility that we need in the type of lives that we live today. The technique I'll share with you and with everybody listening is called the attitude breathing technique. The first step is to really observe our emotions at any given time. And that sounds, well, no big deal, but we don't do that. You know, we race, we run, we live from the neck up, we just, you know, emotions are running, but we don't even pay attention to them, you know. But all the time we have emotions running underneath the surface of our perceptions. So the first step is to recognize what you're feeling and slow down a little bit and say, what am I feeling right now? And if you're feeling an emotion that you don't want, you know, then you're at a place where you can make a choice to begin to transition out of that, to shift it, to transform it. This technique is not about repressing emotions. It's about acknowledging emotions, but it's also about replacing them with emotions that regenerate us versus emotions that are draining us. Let me give you an example. Let's say I'm leaving for the airport, and I get to the airport, and I think I have plenty of time. And then I turn the corner, and there's the line, you know, for security, and it's a lot longer than I thought it was going to be. Well, I'm in the line, and I can stand there, and nobody knows what I'm feeling, and I can look normal to everyone around me, but I could be feeling inside anxious. That anxiousness could then turn into worry. I'm going to miss my flight. It's going to mess up everything. Then that worry and anxiousness can begin to outgate itself into blaming. Like, why don't they get this right? Why does it have to be this way? Can't they get a system that makes any sense? Why do flyers have to go through this? All that can be going on. Those type of emotions are not serving me. They're not bad, but they're not necessarily helping me. They're really burning energy and draining energy from me. If I am observant of that, I can say instead, wait a minute, I can see what's going on here. So I'm going to replace those type of feelings with something that regenerates me. Let's say I'm feeling anxious. I choose the replacement attitude of calm, for example. Anxious to calm. How do I get there? I focus my attention in the heart. You can do this with me right now if you'd like. You drop your attention right down here to the area in the center of your chest. And then you breathe naturally and normally, but a little deeper than you normally would. And as you do that, you pretend as if that breath is flowing in and out right from the center of the chest, right where I have my hand. So you're breathing in and out through this area. And what you want to do is you want to now breathe the feeling of calm. Just breathe it, like feeling calm and breathing it in and out right through the center of the chest. What you're doing is you're now moving out of the anxiousness and integrating in the feeling of calm, and you're anchoring that in so that it's real, so that it has an anchored in feeling state with it. And you can do that, eyes open, standing in the line in the airport security. It doesn't have to be you're off in a meditative state. You're doing it in the moment, right? But you're conscious, and you're breathing that feeling of calm in and out until your system begins to acknowledge that feeling and begins to feel more calm.
So it's instead of just thinking, I want to be calm, I'm calm, you're going through the heart and doing breathing through the heart, and that's where the shift comes.
And trying to make the feeling happen. You know, all heart math techniques have a heart focus and a heart breathing component. Most all do. That's part of it. And breathing techniques are important, and they help a lot of people. And they have helped a lot of people and will continue to help a lot of people. But what I found is that just doing the breathing actually sets the stage for something even more important to happen, and that's the emotional shift. Mm-hmm. Nothing really completes itself out or really has the impact that it needs to have until our emotions agree with it. We can think our way into things, but unless we feel it, you know, the full benefit's not there. The real transition, the real transformation comes through the emotions and making that emotional shift. And that's something that distinguishes our techniques from many of the others, is that we put a lot of emphasis on the emotional shift because we feel that's where the real action is in our emotions. So one of the things heart intelligence does, Yannicka, is it gives us the ability to better understand and regulate our emotions so we can learn to make emotional choices that accelerate us.
Which is very important, because now your research is showing that there is a greater degree of cancer if you have emotional stress, even more than smoking cigarettes.
When we started HeartMath back in 1991, there was hardly any literature on the effect of positive emotions. All the research was on things like anger, you know, and how anger is detrimental, anger kills you, things like that. But very little had been done on positive emotions. Today, through fields like psychoneuroimmunology and other things, there's lots of research now showing that it's healthy, it's beneficial for us to feel positive emotional states, that it regenerates us, that hormones, nervous system, brain, all that is impacted by our emotions. So the link between emotions, health, and disease is quite strong now. And also, beyond that, awareness, consciousness, all those things are directly related to emotions. I don't think we end up in higher states of consciousness and awareness that allows us to see the big picture when we're upset and angry. Doesn't happen, right? We see very limited views. It narrows our perception. We see the problem more than we see the solution. On the other side, when we are in a place where we are feeling more compassion, for ourselves, for starters, a deeper feeling of peace and love. That allows more than intuitive information to enter us. Our consciousness expands, it increases, our awareness gets beyond our normal self. And then we can see problems differently, and we can see solutions differently. But what I just said there is important. What created that would be a shift of emotion. Hmm. Not feeling upset and angry or over-worried about something, instead finding a place of balance, peace, calm, love, compassion. That allows for things to occur and changes to happen more easily, more quickly. So the emotions have a lot to do with, I think, consciousness.
And the intuition is also interpreted in the heart, isn't it?
Well, we have research that indicates that, yeah. I mean, I'm sure intuition is very complex, but we have a study that I'll share with you in a minute. Just to complete the thought on emotion, one of the things that I realized is that one of the highest states of consciousness we could ever have would be to be able to feel like we want to feel when we want to feel that way. And that gets into learning how to use the heart to choose emotions and have them be real. So we can make emotional choices and feel the way we want to feel. That's empowering. That's high state of consciousness applied to making life a better experience. But in terms of intuition, intuition is high-speed intelligence that bypasses a lot of the steps to reach understanding. It's an inner knowingness. One time a woman described intuition to me in a way that I'll never forget. She just casually said, "Oh, I know what intuition is." She said, "It's knowing what you know without knowing how you know it."
Nice.
And so our scientists wanted to begin to see if they could decode the physiology of intuition, what happens when intuition occurs in the body. And so they were looking at it through the lens of what they call a precognitive experience. And they took a study done by one of our colleagues, Dr. Dean Radin, Institute of Noetic Sciences, and they expanded that study. And they did a very, very large and expensive study. It was published in the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine. Those of you that like scientific research, you can get all the research papers and things from the heartmath.org website. Just click the research tab and you can get to the research papers. And it's all there. But this study was published in two parts, a very large study. Here's the way it worked, Yannicka. They had a computer loaded with images. And the images were images that were either very pretty and beautiful or they were horrific. And the computer would randomly select the images. It was not programmed. It was just going to randomly select images. Test subjects were placed in front of the computer and their brain waves, skin response, all kinds of heart measurements were being taken at the same time. They would push a button and there would be a 6-second delay. And then the picture would emerge. Push the button again. 6-second delay, another picture shows up. And they went through a sequence of a certain specific number of these pictures. Data was collected. No big deal. Then the data started to be analyzed. What they found was amazing. They found that in many cases, the body's response to the picture was actually happening 6 seconds before there was a picture. No picture, but the body was doing exactly what it would do if that picture was there. And so they thought, wow, this is amazing. You know, this is showing the precognitive response is real. We are sensing things, you know, before they get there. They continued to analyze the data, and then they had the biggest surprise of all. As they looked at what was happening inside the body, they found that the first part of our physiology that was responding to the picture that wasn't there was not the brain. It was the heart. Heart responded 6 seconds out. About a second and a half later, the brain began to respond to the upcoming picture. Okay. About a second and a half before the picture came on the screen, the two came together. Uh-huh. And so they were showing this merger of heart and brain in before the picture was there. And that was pretty amazing. So what they basically said is, in the summary of the study, is that it appears as if we have this intelligence that we're just unaware of. That the body is constantly scanning for future events. This goes now into quantum physics, you know, beyond time and space. That, you know, we have, this goes beyond time and space limitations that the heart intelligence does. And that our body is constantly doing this, that we just aren't aware of that information. And when I thought about that, I thought, well, if we think about what the new human's going to be like, you know, and the new ways that we'll perceive, the new intelligence that we'll have as we continue to evolve, things like that would be examples of having a greater awareness of what we're sensing about the future, about a future events, moving beyond the limitations that we have today of our time and space box, and being able to operate very differently in a natural way, not something mystical, but in a very pragmatic way. So why would this be important? Well, intuition sometimes is only looked at, Yannick, as like the big things, like the big ahas and the big discovery that came intuitively, you know. And those are important. But intuition has very practical approaches too and applications. It can be things like an intuitive nudge that lets us know when we need to change and when we need to change something, and being more sensitive to those internal intuitive nudges that really are giving us signals of what's going to be best for us, and being more sensitive and accepting of that. Another example might be really having a heightened sense of intuition about when or how to communicate with somebody about something so that it has the best outcome, so that it causes the least amount of friction, so that it has, you know, the most understanding exchange. That requires discrimination. It's not just, hey, let's just get together and talk about it. An intuitive understanding of those kind of things. In business, another example might be, as a business person, myself and other business leaders, we can get lots of information, and we try to make decisions based on the information, on the numbers or on the data, or if we're hiring someone off the resume, you know. But there's always a place I found, and I've talked to other business leaders who have the same experience. There's a place where you can get all the data and the picture's still not clear, and you have to finally decide, you know, and you call upon something a little deeper to make that decision. That's intuition. And that's practical intuition. It's not intuition that's just assigned only to big, you know, unfoldings or, you know, creations of things. It can be very pragmatic, who to hire, when to hire, when to speak, how to speak, what I need to change in myself. Those are just examples of the practical approach that we take here at HeartMath to integrating intuition into daily life.
Another thing that's very interesting is that you're measuring, like, globally emotional states. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I've heard about that. It sounds interesting.
Sounds very interesting.
Would that be interesting? Yeah, one of the projects we started about 5 years ago is one that I'm involved in very heavily as one of the steering committee members and people that helped start it. It's called the Global Coherence Initiative, and that's glcoherence.org for those of you that want to go to the website. What it is a membership organization. Membership, however, is free. You simply just register and you become a member. And we have members, we have about, I think, 55,000 members now. They come from over 100 countries. So it is truly a global coherence initiative. And it's designed to bring people together from all over the world for us to use our heart-focused care and our intention to help shift the, you know, planetary, you know, discord, in harmony, chaos, you know, to something that has more harmony and enduring peace, you know, that kind of a thing. So it's really designed to shift consciousness to create this new world. Now, there are literally thousands of organizations around the world today that are doing something similar like that. They're using prayer, meditation, intention, affirmations, lots of things to help create a new world energetically. And so if you're involved in those things, let me say thank you. We here at HeartMath honor all of that. We respect all the things that other people are doing. With the Global Coherence Initiative, we decided it was time for us to join that party and to bring what we do to that party. Not as better than, not as competitive, but bring what we do. So we have this organization, and we brought our science to the party. So our researchers have developed very sensitive technology that is measuring changes occurring in the Earth's energetic fields. Now, the Earth as a living system produces energetic fields. You've heard the names of some of these. One is called the geomagnetic field. It's what a compass measures. It's created by the spinning of the iron core at the center of our Earth, and it puts an energetic field out. In your part of the world, when you see the aurora borealis, it's when, you know, when that field is being lit up by solar radiation hitting that field, and it creates these beautiful colors. Well, it's hitting the geomagnetic field. And so there's another field that relates to the geomagnetic field. It's called the ionosphere. It's a field that operates just above the atmosphere. It goes about 120 miles up into space. It's less dense than the geomagnetic field. It's very plasma-like. And these two fields work together to create a protective layer around our Earth. They protect us from incoming solar radiation, cosmic rays, all those things that are out in space. If we didn't have the fields, there would be no life here. You and I, this bush, this grass, none of this would exist. So they are part of the Earth. Think about it like a part of our ecology at an energetic level. But they are part of the Earth as a living system. Now, these fields constantly change and fluctuate. And there are a lot of natural occurring things that cause that. Science that's been done for a long time has clearly shown that changes occurring in these fields are affecting us individually and collectively. And there's lots and lots of research out there now that's showing correlating changes in behavior, changes in health, changes in social behavior, all the changes occurring in these fields. Now, I'll try to explain this simply so that I don't lose anyone, but one of the things that creates changes in the fields is changes in the solar activity. So solar cycles, where there's higher activity in the sun of solar flares, sunspots, things like that, are affecting these fields, and those fields then in turn affect us. And there's been interesting research done and studies done showing major changes in society tracking along with the changes in the solar cycles. Everything from the start and end of wars, the start and end of creative periods in time, like the Renaissance, and all kinds of things are tracked to changes in these fields. So we have these fields. They are affecting us, and there are things affecting the fields. We have a hypothesis is that not only are the natural occurring things affecting the fields, but that we, human beings, are. That we have 7 billion plus people on this planet, all producing energetic fields, and that the collective field of humanity is interfacing with the fields produced by the Earth. That it's a two-way street. Fields affecting us, we are affecting the fields. And that mass human emotion, when it's experienced, whether that be positive or negative, could have a measurable impact on these fields. So the sensing technology that we've developed is looking at this and beginning to study this to see more about how these fields are changing, how they're affecting us, and then to continue to test and work towards this hypothesis of proving it or disproving it, that we are impacting the fields. So these sites are called Global Coherence Monitoring Sites. And the research team will eventually need 12 sites, which will cover the Earth strategically located so that they get a picture of the complete energetic field system. Today, as you and I are doing this interview, there are 4.
Where are they?
There's one here in Northern California, about 20 minutes from where we're sitting. There's one in Northern Canada. There's one in the United Kingdom. There's one in Saudi Arabia. There'll be a 5th one placed very soon in New Zealand. There'll be a 6th one placed not long after that in South Africa. And we could place more sensors. They're very expensive, so donations are what's funding them. And there's been Scandinavian people that have donated to make sensor sites happen.
Wonderful.
Eventually we'll have one we need one in Scandinavia, in the Northern Hemisphere there. So eventually there'll be one in Norway or Sweden or someplace. And I'd like to thank the people from Scandinavia or wherever you're viewing around the world really for helping to fund these sites, because it's very, very important scientific research that we're doing. What we're really doing now is we are obtaining funding through donations and help to hire more scientists. Because what we need more than more sensor sites is we need more data analysis. We need more understanding of what we're getting. We're getting all this data, right? What does it mean? And we need scientists that specialize in just that type of work, that are specialized in astrophysics and data processing of that nature, very specific scientific things. So we have some now that we brought on. We've raised some of the money we need, and we're beginning to bring some scientists in to assist with the data analysis. So that's just HeartMath bringing science to it. The other things we do, which the membership tells us are just as important, is that periodically, at least once a month, and then certainly when there are major events happening in the world, we send out messages bringing the collective community together with suggestions on what to send their heart focused care to help ease things, to make things easier for people. Let's say it's a natural disaster, you know, in that area. Earthquake, typhoon, we may send a message saying this area has been affected by this this earthquake, and there are hundreds of thousands of people who are now dealing with it. Let's send our heart-focused care to them in order to help make this an easier process. And so we're using the intention of our collective group to do that. So there are things on the website. There's a room you can go to called the Care Focus Room, where there's a beautiful globe that you can move and manipulate. And when you log in, it puts a little marker on that globe of your internet provider address. Doesn't mean your house. Just means where your internet provider is, which is in your area somewhere. And when you go there, you see all the people that are there when you're there, because their little markers are there on that globe. And you look at this and you go, oh my gosh, look at all these people around the world who are here right now.
Yeah.
Who are putting their heart into something, right? You know, and you see that it's truly global. And when you can go to also that room and you can leave comments. And I like to go there and read the comments, because what I see is I see people from all over the world saying things that are similar, things that are resonant with one another. It could be somebody in Turkey saying something very similar to what somebody in Singapore is saying, or somebody in Norway saying the same thing as somebody in Costa Rica. You know, and you start getting this beautiful understanding of how global this shift is, and how all of us are coming together, regardless of where we live in the world, regardless of, you know, our backgrounds and things like that, that we're relating to one another in a different way. I think that relation is happening because we all have heart, and that we're relating that way.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for this. Is there anything you want to say in the end?
Well, Janneke, first of all, thank you for what you're doing, and for bringing messages and information to people through, you know, your work and your travels. And I honor you for that. And thanks for having an interest in HeartMath and in me. The message I have for you is, please be patient. Be patient and let things unfold. This is a big shift, and it is happening in a very small period of time, but it has to have time to play out. Something this big doesn't happen in one big bang. It has an integrative unfoldment to it. Be patient. Recognize things are moving in the right direction. You don't have to push and drive so hard right now. It's more important to find a place inside yourself that has the forward momentum and intention, but also sort of merges with the flow of it all. So you blend with it and you flow with it, rather than trying to push and drive and beat up on yourself and you're not doing this and you should be doing that. None of that's really going to be as helpful right now as finding that place inside where you have more ease and more flow and more peace, and then you merge with it. And then at the end of my presentations, and I may do this when I'm in Gothenburg, as it sometimes just comes out, is one of the things that I feel for people as I think about people in their lives today, is I want people to have more compassion for themselves.
I love that.
Recognize you're doing the best you can, that you're doing good things in the world, that you are in fact a good person, and that you have made many, many changes in your life already, that you're in a era where things can be a little harder, and that you're doing the best you can in that. So please be compassionate with yourself. You know, find that place inside yourself where you can honor yourself for who you really are and what you're doing and what you have done, and then be at peace with that. That's really important right now. In a way, that's one of the biggest forms of service you, Janneke, or me can do right now, is to be more compassionate with ourselves and let that be our radiational influence into the energetic field environment of planet Earth.
Thank you so much, and have a great trip to Göteborg, and I hope you'll come to Norway.
Okay, darling. Thank you so much. Bye.